Hello students, and today we are going to look into the various waste from the fruit and vegetable production industry that could be used in different applications. And I will be covering different application, and the first application I am today going to discuss in class is pigment production. So you all know that when you look at this picture looks so beautiful and so colorful. You see this brinjal is a very beautifully purple color, strawberries red color, tomato red color. This yellow color is so beautiful. The green shades in these vegetables are so different. And look at these fruits also. The colors, in fact, in the red and yellow, there are so many, you know, variety or differences in the shades of the color. So we all know that if the life doesn't have color, we will feel so like depressed. So we like the colors very much, and therefore be it any food product manufacturing, any new product that is coming in any category, be it a bakery, be it a beverage, or be it a juices, you see that there are different colors. Like you see, to appeal the kids and attract them, there are variety of candies with the different colors. You just name it and you'll find that color is there. Even in the beverages range, there are so many different colors. So currently, all these products that are made are from the synthetic colors. They are added with synthetic color. You see the different candies that are available, that are made, you know, in different colors, are added with synthetic color. Be it beverages, like we saw, you know, there are beverages that are available in different color, be it blue, purple, orange, red, green, yellow, and whatever, so many other colors, carbonated, non-carbonated. So all these food products are made by adding synthetic colors. But consumers are becoming day by day more aware, and they do not want these synthetic colors. So what can be done? So can you think about a natural colors or natural pigments that could be isolated, extracted, and that too from the waste? And we know that these fruits and vegetable, particularly the peels, have different shades of color. And if we try to exploit it, it would be very exciting. So natural pigments or the colorants are not for the first time being used, or not thought for the first time. We know in Indian traditional, we have been using saffron, paprika, turmeric, and flowers of different shades in Indian cuisine. And these natural pigments or colorants can also be used by deriving them from plants or from microbes. So you must have heard about in the laboratory, using downstream processing, we can grow them, cultivate them, and then we can extract those colors. For example, use of specific bacteria or algae, fungi, and yeast and insects, they could be harvested. They could be grown in the laboratory to produce specific colorants. Okay. So, but the problem with these pigments or the natural colorants is that they have a very poor stability. And because of that, their use cannot be exploited. Opposite to that, if you look at the synthetic color, they have a very good high stability, even at a very high temperature, be it baking, boiling, cooking for long, they do not lose their strength of the color. And also they have a very little cost involved. You see, in the market also, the synthetic color that you get are very, very cheaply available. In the bottles, you will get them at a very, very cheaper rate. Maybe, you know, in the market easily available and at a very, very low production cost. And in addition to that, these synthetic pigments also have a high tinctorial strength. What do you mean by tinctorial strength? Means their ability to make or impart the color to the food value is very high. Means you need it in a very, very little quantity, and you would see that they are imparting a very strong color, like yellow color that is being added into the food. Chocolate color, brown color. So they have a very high tinctorial strength, and they are very easy to apply in the food system. You don't need a special skill, or their addition into the food is not at all complicated. Nowadays, the synthetic colors that are being sold either available in the liquid form or in the powder form. Either you mix them with the powder or dissolve it in to either a polar or non-polar base and then mix it into the food system. So they are very easily could be applied into the food system. So this is the table in which it shows the type of pigment and the raw material, and the extraction carried out from the various part of the plants, and the variety of conditions that are used during extractions, whether these pigments are water soluble or water insoluble, about their yield, how much yield could be obtained, and applications or bioactivity and applications. So the first of its kind, the most common one is anthocyanins. So different methods generally are followed, and most common one that is followed is solvent extraction. We know that the solvents are very good examples, and they are solvent extraction method is being followed very commonly in the industry for extraction of these pigments. So apple peel has a very beautiful color. That is, it is because of the anthocyanin, and 80% ethanol or pure ethanol was used in one of the research paper, wherein the author found that 169.7 gram of cyanidin-3 glucoside equivalents like this anthocyanin were measured in the form of cyanidin-3 glucoside per 100 gram from the dried peels. And these extracted pigments were found with a very high antioxidant activity. They also showed a very good free radical scavenger activity, anti-inflammatory, antiviral, anti-cancer property. So if I have a pigment that is extracted from the waste of the apple, that is apple peel, and in addition to the color imparting the tinctorial value to my food, it also provides an antioxidant activity. It will be like a functional food product. So it will impart the color as well as it will also provide a bioactivity to the food in which these are being added. The next example is banana peel. So banana peel have that yellow color, and in one of the study, it was again extracted using solvents such as methanol, ethanol, acetone. I know that these solvents are not useful, or they are useful. Their functionality is very good, but they have a carcinogenic effect. This research was carried out to see if we can extract the yellow pigment from banana using methanol, ethanol, and acetone. And author found that 434 microgram of cyanidin-3 glucoside equivalent was obtained. It was even, you know, greater, like compared to apple peel. Banana peel had more this pigment, and it also showed a very good antioxidant activity, which could be, you know, used or exploited in developing drugs, or used in functional food. Free radical scavenging property was also recorded for such peel. Eggplant or brinjal have a very beautiful peel, and that Under the, we know that under the anthocyanin category, there are different shades, okay, shades of color. So in this research paper, 70% methanol or 70% ethanol or 70% acetone was suggested to extract these pigment of anthocyanin from eggplant or brinjal skin, wherein for different solvent, different yield of this water-soluble pigment was recorded. Say, for example, the maximum yield was recorded with respect to methanol, followed by ethanol and then acetone. And the color and pigments could be very good application in the food. In addition to the color, it could also provide the very good antioxidant property. Similarly for blackberry and grapes also. So if you look at this table, grapes skin showed a very high yield of this anthocyanin pigment of almost 987 to 382 milligrams of these pigments, and a wide application for this color pigments, showing antioxidant, cardioprotective, anti-cancer, anti-inflammation, anti-aging, antimicrobial activity, which are making greater potential for grape in the field of food and pharmaceutical applications. And you must have heard about grapes, their skin and their variety of application due to the health promoting effect. So we all know that in the waste management lecture, you have been studying that the food processing industry, agricultural based, produces enormous amount of waste and byproducts. And recently, yesterday only, there was one report published in which South Asian countries were found producing the largest waste. Okay, so India, unfortunately, or you know, it is the second largest generator of waste after household sewage waste. This food processing industry, agriculture based industry, is the second largest generator of waste. And India is at the second position, China being the first. And that could, there, see, there are reasons also. If we are producing very high, you know that India, China is the largest producer in the world for fruit and vegetable, and India is the second largest. So if you one produces the largest production, then there are also problems like its utilization. So obviously, there will be also a largest waste. At the same time, there is an increased industrialization and urbanization, and also there is a more waste. So, fruit and vegetable waste and their byproducts that are obtained from the processing industries are either seeds, skins, peel, pomace, and from fruit and vegetable to vegetable, the percentage of this waste would be very different. Say, for example, brinjal peel, the percentage waste that is obtained is little lesser. Watermelon rind is around 30 to 40%, whereas strawberry, if you see, the waste percentage is very little during the processing. But if the post-harvest facilities are not properly provided, then that waste could go from 4 to 5% to 80 to 90%. You know, that's again taking another example of strawberry itself. So strawberry in the fresh form, if they produce and then they are processed, the waste could be hardly, you know, 1 or 2% in the form of those cork and the stalks. But if the strawberry, because of its high respiration rate, it has a very poor shelf life. And there, in that case, the strawberry could be spoiled entirely, giving rise to 80 to 90% of the waste. So if you look at the skin portion, peel, seeds, and pomace, they are a very good source of not only pigments, but in addition to the pigments, there are other bioactive constituents such as protein, peptides, polysaccharides, soluble fiber, insoluble fiber, along with the polyphenol, tannin, antioxidant, and natural pigment. So why should we use the natural pigment? So natural pigments are actually gaining a lot of popularity, not only because of the color, because of its being safe. Why they are safe? Because they are chemical free. They would not cause, they will not cause any harm to the body because they are coming from the natural source. So, and in addition to the color or the tinctorial strength, it will also provide an additional health benefits coming from the bioactive constituents such as antioxidant activity. So therefore, because of this additional health promoting effect, these pigments, natural pigments, are used as a colorant as well as pharmacological properties application in the food industry, in the development of functional and nutraceutical food. So this is the figure that shows the natural pigment and their classification. I'm sure by this time you are in final year, so you must have studied the classification somewhere, obviously. Okay, so these natural pigments are classified into two categories: water soluble pigment and a fat soluble or lipid soluble pigment. So there are two types of pigments. Natural pigment are categorized into water soluble and lipid soluble based on the source. Okay, so water soluble further are further includes anthocyanins. Just now we saw a few example in the table form, and anthocyanin, which imparts and ranges from red to blue to purple range. And then comes betalains, which are red, bright red color. Anthocyanin itself have further six categories like cyanidine, malvidine, delphinidine, thionidine, chenudine, and pelargonin. And these betalain further are divided into betacyanin and betaxanthin. Lipid solubles are further categorized into yellow, orange, red, and the green one. Green one are called as a chlorophyll, whereas yellow, orange, red one are most commonly known are carotenoid. So these yellow, orange, red further categorized into carotenes and xanthophyll. And then under the carotenes, you have alpha, beta, and lycopene. Under xanthophyll, you have lutein, zeaxanthin, and beta cryptoxanthin. Chlorophyll further classified as a A and B chlorophyll. So let us quickly understand these pigments and their sources, and which sources are rich, so that when you are deciding on starting a plant as a biorefinery for any source of fruits and vegetable, so one must know that which are the fruits and vegetable sources rich in pigments of these. So let us see first anthocyanin. Anthocyanin, as I said, are water soluble. They are natural, non-toxic, vacuolar, and largest group of polyphenolic pigments. And what are the rich sources of fruits and vegetable in which they are available in the concentrated forms? Most common one you must have seen, the purple or red cabbage, the black carrots, radish, which are red, purple sweet potatoes, and amongst fruits, black currants, cherries, berries such as strawberries, blackberries, chokeberries, raspberries, which are black in color, blueberries, gooseyberries, especially not the yellow one but the black one, and Concord grapes, etc. So these are all very good sources of these anthocyanin pigments. So we just now saw that this anthocyanin is a water soluble, which belongs to the class of flavonoids, with the major plant-based anthocyanin being. And then it has a further category like cyanidine, pelargonidine, delphidine, and when you are depending upon the source, the it is measured in the different, you know, using these different standards. So these are like pelargonidine, delphinidine, pionidine, petunidine, malvidine. So the you will see that the wide range of this color from red, blue to purple. So this color difference in anthocyanin is due to the structural differences in hydroxyl group and their number and the position of sugar moieties. I am sure you have done this chapter in one of the few of the chemistry lecture that you have done in the past. So we are not going to detail the structures and how they are affecting, but quickly we will see the ranges of, you know, these colors, pigments that are coming from the sources. So mostly this anthocyanin is concentrated in the sources which are coming from wine industry, and generally wine is prepared from these blue hues or blue red colored grapes, and this is because of this anthocyanin color. You see there are different types of juices that could be made from blackberries, blueberries, orange or red colored food, or turquoise blue colored fruits. So all these, you know, pigments coming from the fruits juice industry. So fruit juice industry and wine industry would be a very good or potential source of these pigments, anthocyanin pigments. So it was observed that this is in the form of cyanidine. So these blackberry residues obtained was found with a very high amount of anthocyanin in the form of cyanidine. So 1 gram was observed with 4.31 milligram of cyanidine anthocyanin. Then apple pomace, I have already, you know, discussed this is from that same table. So apple peel showed a 169.7 milligram cyanidine 3 glucoside equivalent per 100 gram of dried apple peel powder. Similarly, grape pomace. The next category is a betaline category, and this betaline is coming into coming from the variety of different, you know, fruits and flowers. So so these betalines, as we saw in the previous figure, that they are coming from the different sources as well as classified as beta cyanine and beta xanthine, and they have a range of color that is between the range of red to purple or yellow to orange color, coming from the different fruits and vegetables. So this is found as a pigment in Vita vulgaris. Beetroot is a most common one. You see, you cut the beetroot and you will see that, you know, that color pigment is so high and concentrated. And also its, you know, tinctorial strength is also very, very high. Very little quantity is needed. If you put it into the food, the entire food will become that red color, dark red color. It's a very, very good, you know, color. So it is because of this betadine's color. Then prickly pears are also in this red to purple color. Opuntia, that is also called as a prickly pear. Pins are found in the beetroot most commonly, but there are other sources also that are like rich in these betalines. So microwave assisted extraction was carried out and for extraction of these betaline content was observed to be 201.6 to 1.32.9 milligram per gram. It's very, very high, you know. In 1 gram, you will see that, you know, it's a very highly concentrated. With methanol, you see that the yield is very high, and without methanol, it's almost like 132. So methanol gives a very good, you know, yield. So this was just an example. I see there are other methods also for extraction, which I will cover and discuss in the next slide. But the next pigment in this category is carotenoids. Carotenoids, as you see, this coming from the source, that is carrot. So, right, recently the carrots are gaining popularity because of their juice and the health promoting effect this carrot provides. We know that the carrots also gives rise to vitamin A activity. It's a precursor of vitamin A, and it has anti-cancer property, and there are lots of health promoting effect. So these carotenoids are not water soluble like anthocyanin and the pigments, but these are lipophilic in nature, and that is why vitamin A is a fat soluble vitamin A, and this is a phytochemical which is a fat soluble in nature, accounting from red, yellow or orange color. So these carotenoids widely occur all as either trans or cis isomers. We know that cis are the natural forms, and then during processing or extraction, the transforms are also formed. So these carotenoids are mainly categorized into carotenes and xanthophylls. So carotenes has alpha, beta, and lycopene, and whereas xanthophylls covers lutein, zeaxanthin, and beta cryptoxanthin. So both these carotenes as well as xanthophylls contain a chain of hydrogen, carbon. I'm sure in chemistry of food constituent you must have done this in detailed, the structure, the chemistry, its degradation, its stability, when you add into the food what happens to that. So in this lecture I'm not going to discuss that in detail, but you should be aware that these carotenoids pigments contain a chain of hydrogen and carbon, and the presence of this hydroxyl group represents the oxygenated carotenoid in structure, and therefore you know it differentiate them. So there are a number of sources, carrot being the most common and concentrated form, but bell pepper or the paprika is another rich source of red carotenoids. So paprika means those bell peppers are there in different color, green, red or yellow. So capsanthin pigment is found in the fruits of capsicum anacum, that is paprika, or piri piri. So they are like under the same category, and also as per European food legislation, this capsanthin is listed as natural food colorant. Also commercially available carotenoids can used as a food coloring compounds, and they are used usually synthesized chemically also. So however, currently to boost the green consumerism, these pigments can be produced from waste generated by the fruit and vegetable industry. So again, in few research, although I couldn't find any commercial operation in which the extractions are being commercialized, all these research findings are still in the laboratory, and they are not being, you know, exploited commercially. So paprika waste was observed with in 1 gram of paprika waste, there was 232.60 microgram of lutein was recorded. Tomato peel was also recorded for a very high carotenoid content. Carrot peel and their byproducts were also recorded for a very good content of these carotenoids. But these were all observed with solvents, and as you know that the, some of the solvents are carcinogenic in nature, and they are not good for human health. So green extraction approaches are being followed, wherein you know either one can use for the fat soluble pigment, one can use for variety of oils that could be used, or otherwise there are green solvents like salts and the liquid biphasic solvents and liquids are coming which are green in nature. Maybe it is just a hot water or the solvents that are green in nature. So carotenoids and beta carotenes were observed from the carrot pomace, from the carrot juice, carrot waste, and it was quite a high amount that was observed. Leucine carotenoids were observed to be 82.66 microgram per gram of apple pomace or carrot pomace, and similarly, sunflower oil and soya oil as a green solvents were used instead of methanol in combination with ultrasound for the extraction of carotenoid. Ultrasound technology is coming as a newer technology, which is proving to be a very good technology for the extraction of pigment and many other compounds because of its capacity to, you know, break the cells and then, you know, sometimes these pigments are present into the intracellular cells or vacuole. So this ultrasound treatment can break those cells very easily and can bring out the more yield. So again, pomegranate peels, carotenoids peels, lycopenes and beta carotene from tomato byproducts or peels or pomace were extracted using supercritical carbon dioxide. You must have heard about supercritical carbon dioxide extraction is another green technology which gives a very good yield. So for example, you know, the oils or the bioactive constituents that could be extracted using a simple cold press, wherein the yield obtained is hardly 40 to 50%, but in the carbon dioxide extraction, almost 92 to 95% yield of these bioactives could also be obtained. The next pigment in the category is chlorophyll. So we know that chlorophyll is a green pigment which is extensively dispersed in plants, leaves, everywhere you see this green color is because of the chlorophyll, and it is an oil soluble amphiphilic pigment. So these chlorophyll molecule constitute a hydrophilic ring, that is porphyrin group head, and a lipophilic hydrocarbon tail, that is a phyton group. Similar to lutein, due to its lipophilic nature or hydrocarbon chain as a phytol tail, it is generally insoluble in polar solvent, but obviously soluble in the non-polar solvent. Chlorophyll is found in plant foods, and they are again of two types, based on again color structure, or and especially the presence of the CH3 group. So chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B are the two categories. So at position 7 of carbon, methyl group, CH3 group is present in the chlorophyll A, whereas aldehyde group, that is CHO group, is present in the chlorophyll B. Otherwise, they are almost similar, except for this structural difference. So why different colors of the chlorophyll? In the chlorophyll itself, you will see that there are shades and different colors. So difference in the structure leads to a different colors of chlorophyll, be it the blue-green, which is because of chlorophyll A, or yellow-green, which is because of the chlorophyll B, that is presence of aldehyde CHO group, okay? Demand for this chlorophyll is continuously increasing, corresponding to its enhanced awareness on the use of natural colorants as well as health benefits that are imparted by them. So you see, you know, the green cucumber or the watermelon peels that are very, very green in color. So the chlorophyll content that was observed in one of the research paper reported for these was like for cucumber 3.46 milligram in 1 gram and 5.28 milligram in 1 gram of watermelon peel. This chlorophyll was reported. In addition to that, this cucumber and watermelon peels showed also a very good antioxidant activity, and among all the tasted vegetable variety, which was attributed exclusively because of the chlorophyll content. Avocado peel also indicated to be a very good source of chlorophyll pigment, which ranged from higher than, you know, even this chlorophyll and watermelon, and 25 to 66 microgram per gram. So avocado being a very rich source of this chlorophyll pigment, it could be also used to fortify as a coloring agent, green coloring agent in variety of food formulations. So as of now, we have not, explored, and all of the most of the extraction techniques that are being used are in the laboratory scale only. So succinate extraction technique is most commonly used technique for extraction of these pigments, and these using either organic or inorganic solvents or maceration techniques or hydrodistillation techniques, they have been widely used for extraction of these natural pigments. So generally, for a conventional extraction, water or diluted alcohol are used to extract water-soluble pigments. But what about those are non-water soluble or non-polar solvents? They could be used, using the non-polar solvents could be used for the extraction of the lipid-soluble pigments. So the non-polar solvents used for the extraction of the pigments are either petrochemical origin, for example, hexane, to be used for the extraction of chlorophyll or carotenoids from the variety of plant waste. Acetone could be used for lycopene or from tomato pulp waste. Ethanol to be used for anthocyanin from eggplant peel, trifluoroacetic acid for the extraction of betaline from pitaya fruit or beetroot. Most of them are mainly toxic in nature, though owing to their volatile nature, they can effectively dissolve the target pigment to facilitate the convenient removal. Rather than being technically advantageous, these traces of these solvents are unsafe for human consumption, and that are leading to, they are very carcinogenic in nature. So they are leading to carcinogenic risk in humans and can also contribute to environmental pollution. So this use of greener extraction technique is now considered to be a very emerging and rediscovering an innovative method, gaining much popularity and acceptance in the industry, food processing industry, and towards avoiding the adverse effects of the synthetic solvent, be it to the environment or to the human consumption. So this table gives an overview on various techniques that could be used for extraction of these pigments and their advantages and few drawbacks and few, pigments and the yield that could be obtained. So ionic liquids are becoming very, very famous, and these are few examples of the ionic liquids that are explored. And although these are at laboratory scale only, but yes, they could be successfully used. So these ionic liquids are getting replaced with the traditional solvents in order to, dissolve and extract the bioactive constituent of the different, nature, be it water-soluble or lipid-soluble. So this study was carried out for tomato waste and orange peel, and lycopene and carotenoids were extracted respectively from tomato as well as orange, and the yield recorded was very interesting. In case of orange peel, 32.08 microgram per gram of orange peel, this pigment, carotenoid pigment, were extracted. So the conventional yield with the it was like using this ionic liquid, the yield was even higher than the acetone. See, acetone was able to extract only 7.88 micrograms of carotenoids, whereas using this ionic liquid, you see there is much, much higher yield that is obtained. So advantage of these ionic liquids is like it is chemically inert, it is thermally stable, and the high extraction rate was observed, and it is environmentally safe also. However, the drawback at this point of juncture is like it is not at all economical. As I said, these ionic liquids are very, very expensive, high preparation cost in their extraction. Supercritical fluid extraction is again a very well-known extraction method, which is accepted widely, and its yield is also very, very good compared to the conventional method. So if you see, tomato peels were studied for extraction of the lycopene, and using the hexane, only 608 microgram per gram of yield was obtained. But using the supercritical fluid, where there is no solvent, you just use the carbon dioxide under pressure, and you see 728.98 microgram. In fact, it is very, very high than ethanol, which is just 284. So it is very, very good, environmentally safe, very fast, highly selective. But there are a few drawbacks. It is greatly impacted by the property of the fluid that is being used. Then next is pressurized liquid extraction or accelerated solvent extraction technique. So in this, the concept is like, in this method, high pressure is used to extract the compound while using also higher temperature. So, but because of the higher temperature, there might be chances that the bioactives might get, degraded. So the advantage of this method is like, it has a very good faster extraction, reduced solvent usage, higher operating temperature, increases the diffusion rate. However, it comes with few drawbacks of extraction efficiency greatly varies with temperature, pressure, and type of solvent used. Ultrasound assisted extraction, you all know how widely it is being used. So in this, the concept involved is leaching of the bioactives from the plants via cavitation phenomena using ultrasounds between the range of 20 kilohertz to 100 kilohertz. So tomato waste, again, you know, extracted for lycopene, and a very good yield from 1.23 milligram in the conventional extraction was, you know, increased up to 5.11 milligram per gram. So there are multiple advantages coming with this ultrasound assisted extraction. It is analytically very simple, more efficient, lower extraction temperature compared to the other method, and faster processing time. But right now, ultrasound assisted extraction is coming to be with a very high cost, and you need a specialized setup, that is ultrasound assisted setup. Then the next one is microwave assisted extraction. So here the concept is the concentrated, the solvent is like allowed to penetrate into the waste solid matrix by using, you know, the microwave, microwaves. So here 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz microwaves could be used to help in penetrating that solvent into the waste, so that the yield could be improved or yield could be higher. So black currant mark was extracted for anthocyanin pigment using conventional extraction method. 12.5 milligrams of anthocyanin was obtained, whereas using microwave assisted extraction, the yield was increased to 20.4 milligram. So the advantages of these techniques are, this is maximum anthocyanin yield obtained after 10 minutes using this microwave assisted extraction, while using conventional extraction after 300 minutes. Okay, so there is like a lot of saving of the time, and also lesser solvent quantity used which will bring down the cost also. However, it is a highly energy consuming, not at all cost effective. There is more energy consumption, that means it will be expensive, and also there are a lot of external factors that would affect, like temperature, pressure, power frequency, etc., and it will greatly affect the output as well as efficiency or yield or extraction yield. High voltage electric discharge is yet another method of extraction of the bioactive compound by damaging the cell structure to form a gaseous cavities followed by phase decompositions. So vegetable waste source that was studied using this method. There are many, many research papers, but I'm just giving one example under each category, wherein polyphenols were extracted from grape stem extract, and a very good yield was obtained, showing its very good efficiency. Enhanced mass transfer was observed, and also lower operating temperature would protect the bioactive constituent that are present in the grape stem. However, it is again very expensive, and voltage fluctuation can badly affect on the amount of yield. Pulsed electric field, applying a pulse electric field between the range of 100 to 300 volt per centimeter to 20 to 80 kilovolt per centimeter onto the waste material put between two electrodes at room temperature can result into a very good yield, from 20% to 90% yield of the bioactives, that is that vitalins and anthocyanins were extracted from beetroot and grape pomace. And it was observed that initially using the conventional extraction, only 20% yield could be obtained, but that was enhanced to 90%. So there is a very good enhanced extraction obtained from pulse electric field from plant residue. But only biggest disadvantage that comes along with this methodology is a very, very high consumption of energy, and therefore leading to high cost. And also you need a very special setup to perform this technique. So in addition to that, like there are many other techniques. Just now we discussed in the table, ultrasound assisted, microwave assisted, enzyme assisted, supercritical fluid extraction, pressurized liquid extraction, pulse electric field, ionic liquids. In addition to that, hot water, ethanol, esters of fatty acids or oils of fruits and vegetables such as soybean, rapeseed oil, cocoa oils, etc., glycerol, they could be used for the increasing the extraction yield. Okay, so we have overall seen, so these are different extractions techniques that could be employed for extraction of these bioactive constituents from the variety of vegetable source. So we know that the solvents are very toxic in nature, and they are discouraged to use, and therefore more friendly, environmental friendly, greener techniques are being encouraged. And also the consumer want everything in the natural form. So in Kerala there is one industry who is looking for additives and such bioactives which have antimicrobial property, like preservatives or additives which are coming from the natural form. So we know that some of the bioactives constituent that are extracted from these waste also provides antimicrobial, so that could be used as a preservative. Cold extraction methodologies that also coming gaining popularity because they maintain the natural composition in its intact form, because we know that the bioactive constituents coming into the natural sources, it's very sensitive to heat, and therefore stability of these extracted compounds while requiring lower energy, less number of process steps, a reduction in setup size, better mass and heat transfer, and higher yield could be obtained. So again, these are few examples that are also given in the table format. For example, supercritical carbon dioxide extraction was found more effective using for the extraction of chlorophyll and lutein from spinach byproducts, and confirmed to be providing a very higher recovery of phytopigments, that is 70% for lutein and 96% for chlorophyll when compared with the conventional methods of using acetone. So there is a problem that we need to improve the stability of this pigment. So increase in the stability of pigment is could be done by variety of way. Okay, we will use the greener technique, but what about the stability? Because we know that these pigments itself, compared to the synthetic forms, are having poor stability. So the stability of these pigments can be increased by various concentration in the system, like you can modify the pH. So we know that some of the pigments, like they behave differently. Like a very good example is anthocyanin. At lower pH and higher pH, the stability is different. So low pH and temperature could be exploited or modified. Presence of another stabilizer, your use of chelating agents or antioxidants along with the bioactives that are extracted, or packaging those bioactives or extracted material in such a packaging material that it provides protections against light and other things. Okay, it prevents the oxidations. micro or nano encapsulations are coming into as a new area of research. Like this is a very, very promising concept. And you know that if the bioactive constituents are extracted and if you encapsulate them using variety of encapsulation techniques, be it a nano encapsulation or micro encapsulation. So best suited technique for the entrapment of the natural pigment in the coating enclosure is to enhance their shelf life. So it gives the protection from moisture, oxygen, temperature, light, and therefore the stability could be enhanced much, much faster way. So the most common one is used method is spray drying method. You all are aware about spray drying technique, which is an encapsulation technique wherein you use a core material and coating material. And the coating material used are starches, gum arabic, maltodextrins, and the spray drying is widely used for the encapsulation of the natural colorants in the powdered formulation, and it is very, very rapid and a reliable modern technique. So basically during spray drying, the free flowing ability, the quality, the powder efficiency, bioactivity of natural pigments after drying treatment depends on variety of conditions, like what temperature the spray drying is carried out, what is inlet temperature, what is outlet temperature, what is atomization speed, feed rate, carrier to feed ratio, and there are many things that one need to optimize before one goes for the spray drying techniques. Okay, so there were several studies that were reported on the use of encapsulation, be it micro or nano encapsulation, for improving the stability of this pigment, and most common one was spray drying. So freeze drying, electro spinning, nanofibers, or complex bioservation, micro spare for the encapsulation of natural pigments. These are a variety of techniques that could be also used in addition to the spray drying. But these, if you see spray drying or electro spinning, so compared to spray drying, this comes out to be very, very expensive. So spray drying is the best technique for the encapsulation of natural colorants because of its minimal exertions, rapid, and it's very reliable modern technique. And it results into providing the end product, which is a free flowing, very good quality product. It has a very good powder efficiency at the shelf stability of the bioactive constituent that is being encapsulated using a core material. Also, the core and the coating material is very cheap, like sometimes modified starches, maltodextrins are used, gum arabic, they are being used, and they provide a very good protection. So encapsulation of natural pigment, so stability is one of the very important issue that could be easily sorted out using this micro encapsulation technique. And so this is a overall figure that shows variety of health promoting effect that can be obtained from these bioactive constituents. So for example, beta carotene from beet carotenoid peel or carrot peel, betalain from beetroot, anthocyanin from berries, lycopene from tomato, chlorophyll from a variety of vegetable sources. So these are all natural pigments, and they have already proven antioxidant property, antimicrobial property. They also promote immunity boosting, anti-cancer, hypoglycemic effects, and they have a scavenging effect. So you have already studied in much detail about the bioactivity and their health benefits promoted by these. I am not going to cover it in detail, but to give you a brief overview, like all of these bioactive rich constituent, like coming from berries, blackberries, blueberries, gooseberries, chokeberries. So these fruits have a lot of waste, which is carrying along a lot of pigments, and these pigments have been proven with a very good antioxidant compound, example anthocyanin, flavonoids, vitamin E, vitamin C, phenolic compounds, fibers, carotenoids, and other antioxidants are the key bioactive compounds that are present into these waste, and these could be exploited, making them valuable source for providing these health promoting effects. So one of the studies, seed pomace waste of both raspberry and blackberry was observed to be a very good source of antioxidants besides containing omega-3. Like you know that omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids are good for health. So these oils can be a potential source of bioactive compounds such as polyphenols, tocopherols, carotenoids, and sterols, which are, you know, recognized and proven to be a very good antioxidant agents. Cranberry leaves and pomace were exploited and they showed a very good polyphenol content, resulting into a high antioxidant property. Orange peel also showed a very effective in protecting against hydrogen peroxide free radicals and induced DNA damage on human leukocytes. Right now, the seasons of mangoes and these mango peels were observed to, you know, shown with the anti-cancer property, and this manganeferrine compound was a bioactive compound, a naturally occurring bioactive xanthonoid was extracted from the mango tree for the cancer treatment, and this was observed to be a very good antioxidant, showing anti-inflammatory property. This manganeferrine can be used either individually or in conjunction with other anti-cancer chemicals, and it is potentially very beneficial in treating lung cancer, brain, cervix cancer, prostate and breast cancer and leukemia. Black raspberry seed waste can also cause, shown to be apoptosis in colon cancer cells, resulting into suppressed cellular spread. Likewise, tomato peel and apple waste, beetroot peel have shown a very good anti-cancer activity. Anti-inflammatory properties were also obtained and observed into observed from a variety of natural pigments coming from the waste of fruits and vegetable. And there was a study in which the polyphenolic compounds and anthocyanin compounds, especially that are coming from citrus peel or citrus pomace, was very effective in showing immunity boosting or showing a regulatory inflammatory response. Look at this picture again, purple cabbage. So limonene present into the citrus waste act as anti-inflammatory, antibacterial, antioxidant and anti-cancer agent. Purple cabbage particularly, or cauliflower byproducts containing phenolic compound showed a very good activity against this cancer, that is anti-carcinogenic and anti-inflammatory effects were reported. Antimicrobial activity was reported from the fruit extract mainly of peel and is likely to be caused by the presence of colored pigments, anthocyanin, carotenoids, etc., which exhibits multiple antimicrobial mechanisms and synergies inside a microbial cell. Avocado peel extract exhibited elevated antimicrobial potential than nisin, a naturally occurring dipeptide and with antimicrobial property. Additionally, avocado peel extracts also exhibited antimicrobial properties against Listeria innocua, E. coli, Legionella mesenterites, and others. Grapeseed oil has been proven to have antimicrobial properties. Anti-obesity activity. The natural phytopigments, mainly anthocyanin and carotenoids, were envisaged to play a very significant role in lessening obesity, contributing towards a decrease in adipose tissue, that is a fat deposition. Mango waste was found to be a very good antioxidative and anti-inflammatory agent. Also, it was shown to be a very promising agent in reducing obesity and diabetes. Neuroprotective effect and managing intestinal health and in prevention of skin disorders, particularly the cancers and cardiovascular diseases, were observed by some of these waste material. Banana peel also showed. Banana peel extract has been found to deliver a very strong neuroprotective effect. So in conclusion, there are a variety of techniques, extraction techniques that could be exploited to extract the natural pigments of a different color from the vegetable waste, which is actually a waste for particularly fruit and vegetable waste. It's a very, very high amount of waste altogether. So these green extraction techniques could be used to extract the pigments, and to increase the stability of this pigment, they could be encapsulated using variety of techniques, and then these pigments from coming from the natural origin can be fortified and made into a functional food, like those products in which these are fortified. They